Hyperion Audiobooks presents Clark's Big Book of Bargains, written by Clark Howard and Mark Meltzer, and read by Clark Howard.
This book is about spending money. I'd like every dollar you earn to buy more and last longer. Making better spending decisions lets you take control of your life and gain more financial security. Every day on my radio show, I talk to listeners around the country whose spending and the resulting debt is causing tremendous stress in their lives. I want to help you turn down the pressure so you don't have to worry when you open the mailbox about the bills waiting for you. The average American now owes more money than they earn in a year, according to data compiled by the Wall Street Journal. It's not what you earn that matters, it's what you spend. If you spend less than you earn, you can take the dollars you don't consume and put them aside into building long-term financial security for you, your children, their education, and your retirement. This program is about choices you can make that will allow you to live a debt-free lifestyle, or at the very least, a lifestyle that puts you in control of your money. I'm certainly not suggesting you do everything we discuss. Look for ideas that work for you. Add your own. The goal is to create a new way of thinking about spending before you spend. I hope Clark's Big Book of Bargains helps you get more for your money and feel better about your financial future. Chapter 1. Food. There are a few common sense rules that can help you save on your grocery bill. The first, shop with a list. If you go into a supermarket without a list, you're going to fall prey to the store's marketing tactics. You'll buy things that are displayed at end caps. That's the end of each aisle. You'll also be tempted by merchandise that's positioned at eye level. Often foods with a lot of fat and calories, they're going to earn a higher profit for the store and be awful for your health. The store's goal? Get you to buy things you hadn't intended to buy. Using a list helps you fight that. The second rule, never go to the supermarket when you're hungry, because you're much more likely to make impulse buys when you're hungry. If you do just those two things, you can make a huge difference in your grocery bill. There are a number of techniques that will help you save money on the things you buy. One, using discount coupons. There are a couple of dangers to coupons. One is that you might buy products you don't need just because you have the coupon. Or you'll fall victim to the manufacturer's strategy, which is to get you hooked on a product with a coupon so you'll buy it again and again at full price. There are a number of websites you can go to get grocery coupons. Among them are cutouthunger.org, salesmountain.com, and couponmountain.com. And of course, any website I give you in the book, remember it starts www. A number of supermarkets and pharmacies across the country are now offering discount cards that you can use to obtain special advertised prices. You don't have to pay for the card. You simply show it at the register upon checkout and you get the special deals. But many people don't like them because the store can track you, everything you buy with that card. It's an invasion of your privacy. How about me? I'm willing to give up some of my privacy to get the bargain. But you might want to avoid using the card when you're making a purchase you wouldn't want tracked, like, for example, getting some medicine or something else that would feel real personal. Costco, Sam's Club, and BJ's Wholesale, roughly a third of the merchandise in the warehouse clubs are grocery items, and they're significantly cheaper than the regular price at the grocery store. But you know, they won't be cheaper than the sale price at the grocery store. If you're not a regular warehouse club shopper, you might think all you're going to get is huge restaurant-sized jars of stuff. But it's not like that anymore. They may make you buy two of a regular-sized item, two supermarket-sized bottles of apple juice, for example, but you don't have to buy giant-sized stuff. I want you to be real careful about product sizes at your regular supermarket. The larger sizes of products used to give you the best value. Not anymore. I want you to take a calculator with you when you go to the supermarket, in case the store doesn't have shelf tags with the unit prices. You can quickly divide the price per number of items and get a unit price to see which size is best. If a product that you regularly buy is on sale, make sure to stock up. Another way to save is to shop at one of the two discounters that are changing the supermarket business. Walmart, which is on its way to becoming the nation's largest supermarket chain, and Aldi, a deep discount chain that's spreading across the country. Walmart supercenters, which are combination Walmart stores and grocery stores, almost without question, have the lowest grocery prices, because groceries aren't as important to Walmart as getting people to buy items on both sides of the store. Aldi uses a smaller store format, and while it sells both perishables and non-perishables, it limits the selection to a tiny fraction of what's available in a normal supermarket. By doing that, it's able to sell merchandise at a much higher volume with lower prices. And customers I talked with said they love the quality of Aldi's store brands. Aldi shoppers said they estimate they could buy $100 worth of groceries for $55 to $60. I saw a more official study that said grocery shopping at the big supermarket chains, Kroger and Albertsons, cost shoppers 38 to 43% more than buying groceries at Walmart. You can save huge money by trying store brand products, which are usually cheaper, and the quality of store brands is very good in most categories. Here's what I'd love for you to do. Try the store brand food. If you don't like it in a particular category, don't buy it anymore. Go back to buying your brand name. You've wasted your money one time on something that tasted crummy. But if you find a store brand you like, you're going to save money every time you go to the store. Don't buy non-food items in a supermarket. In the non-food aisle, supermarkets are selling convenience, not price. If you buy your toilet paper, soaps, detergents, or diapers for your kids in a supermarket, you're going to eat up your wallet. That's why Walmart scares the daylights out of the major supermarkets, because they've been massive profit categories for the supermarkets. Walmart sells its groceries at a lower markup, and it sells its non-groceries at a lower markup. Supermarkets also charge more for convenience foods, but not always, and even if they do, that isn't always bad. Something that's cooked for you or chopped up for you may cost more than something you had to prepare yourself, but it may not. Consumer Reports studied prepackaged bags of salad greens, expecting to find it was a terrible ripoff compared to the cost of buying lettuce and carrots and chopping them up yourself. But the magazine found the salad bags were fairly priced. I eat about 80% of my meals out, and that's not a smart financial strategy. But if you do want to eat out, at least occasionally, and not spend a fortune, I have some tips that will make a huge difference in what you spend. In a fine restaurant, the big profit centers for the restaurant are alcohol, appetizers, and dessert. You'll lower the bill by about a third if you treat the main course as the main reason you've gone out and avoid all the extras, especially the alcohol and the dessert. If you like to have a drink before your meal, have a glass of wine before you go to the restaurant. I look at restaurants the way I do travel. If you travel economically, you create more opportunity to travel. If you eat out economically, you're free to eat out more frequently. Instead of treating a restaurant meal as a very rare, extra special pleasure, where you spend a fortune whenever you go, why not instead afford yourself the opportunity to enjoy that special meal more often? If you enjoy wine with your dinner, you might be able to bring your own, depending on the law where you live. If it's legal, many different kinds of restaurants will allow this, even very upscale restaurants. Call ahead and ask, and tell the restaurant we have our own favorite wine. If they allow it, they'll charge a corkage fee, usually $3 to $10 for each bottle, which covers their cost to uncork the wine and serve it using their glasses. The markup on a bottle of wine is so large that you'll still save a ton of money. Desserts take an even bigger bite out of your wallet than alcohol. They're gigantically profitable for the restaurant. Another thing to beware of are specials. Some people feel it's impolite to ask the cost when a server's describing the specials, but to me, it's impolite that the description doesn't include the cost. I ask. At mid-level restaurants, the best way to save money is the time of day you visit. While high-end restaurants would not stoop so low as to have peak and off-peak pricing, mid-price restaurants are really practical about this. They'll offer early bird or late evening savings opportunities, or a limited menu of special items if you order before 7 p.m. One of the coolest ways to save money at high-end restaurants is to eat lunch there instead of dinner. The lunch menu usually will have the same or similar items as the dinner menu, but they're cheaper at lunch. Since I don't buy a lot of extras at restaurants, I have a lower total bill, and that could mean shortchanging the server. So if the server's been delightful, I often tip 25% of the bill, much more than the 15 to 20% guideline. I may be frugal, but it's really important to be generous when it comes to tipping. In a high-end restaurant, buying the special can cost you, but at fast food restaurants, where I have my greatest culinary expertise, buying the special will save you a lot of money. Most fast food restaurants offer rotating specials featuring one of their burgers or sandwiches. For example, McDonald's now has the dollar menu. Right now, you'd find a chicken sandwich and a fish sandwich on it. Burger King has a number of items on its 99-cent menu, and Wendy's has a regular 99-cent menu. You'll do your body and your wallet a favor if you buy whatever burger or sandwich is on special and skip the French fries, which are the highest profit margin item. Your doctor would be happy to tell you that French fries aren't his or her choice for you as a vegetable anyway. Fast food restaurants love to sell you combo meals and tell you what a great discount you're getting by buying it because the burger, the fries, and drink cost less in combo than they would if you bought them individually. Drinks are pretty expensive, even at 99 cents. My co-author Mark Meltzer often buys a burger and a salad at Wendy's for $1.98, takes it back to the office to enjoy with a 50-cent drink from the vending machine, a glass of water, or a soda he brought from home and chilled in the office refrigerator. You may think I'm crazy watching a few dollars to this degree, but it adds up. According to an article in Money Magazine, if you skip the $4 gourmet coffee and croissant every morning and instead put the $80 a month into a mutual fund, you could have $146,000 in 25 years. Saving a few dollars a day on breakfast or lunch can turn into a lot of money. The entertainment coupon book is especially good for saving money on mid-priced and fast food restaurants, with a lot of buy one, get one free offers. The purpose of these deals is to get you into a place that maybe you don't...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.